brand new class on the Yale University syllabus immediately became the most popular class ever in the history of the school. The course's official title is Psych 157, Psychology and the Good Life, but everybody calls it the Happiness Course. It quickly enrolled more than 1,200 students, according to the Yale Daily News. There were so many students that class had to be held in a concert hall. But its popularity didn't end at Yale. The course soon became a viral sensation. It was featured in the New York Times, the Washington Post, New York Magazine, the Times of India, France's Le Figaro, and many more. Demand was so high, there's now a version of the course available for free on the web. What is all the fuss? Well, let's find out from the source. Professor Lori Saunders joins me now.
Thanks so much for having me.
So Lori, you're in the psychology department at Yale. Why did you decide to teach this class?
So the class came out of a different role I had at Yale, which is I became one of Yale's heads of college. So Yale's kind of like Hogwarts, where it's Gryffindor and Slytherin. I'm head of Silliman College, and that means I live on campus with the students. You know, I eat with them in the dining hall and hang out in their coffee shop. And that means I saw them kind of in the trenches in terms of what they were really going through. And as a faculty member, I was shocked at the kind of mental health issues I was seeing, frankly. And this is the kind of thing that folks report not just at Yale, but is just a national trend that's getting worse. So a recent National College Health Survey showed us that about 30% of students report being so depressed it's difficult to function. Over 50% of college students report being anxious a lot of the time. And over 80% say that they feel overwhelmed by all they have to do. And you know, this was not my college experience. It's not the kind of spot where we're going to be educating students well if they're this depressed and this anxious.
The data suggests that over the years, people have been asking for more and more mental health at colleges. Why do you think this is happening?
I don't know. I think there are a number of different things at work. I mean, my sense is that colleges are often prioritizing the kinds of things that science suggests just aren't very good for well-being. You know, students are over-focused on grades. They're really future-focused about what kind of job they're going to get later, even at a place like Yale, where most of them are going to get good jobs. And those are not the kinds of things that promote well-being. Well-being comes from being in the moment. It comes from social connection. It comes from counting your blessings and not worrying about the things in the future.
So when you talk about the social connections and social interaction, and all the research suggests actual physical social interaction is very useful in giving people a sense of well-being. It seems to me that particularly for younger generation, they live in a world of social media interactions more than social interactions. Do you think that plays a role?
Yeah, I think it's no coincidence that these kinds of mental health issues are coming up in this age where technology is pulling away the kind of normal social interaction we have. And that's true on social media, where I think people think they're getting some social connection out of scrolling their Instagram feed, but they haven't talked to a live person. They haven't made a real social connection. But it's not just social media. It's also all kinds of other tech, right? You know, we don't talk to our cab driver and explain where we're going because we've punched it into, you know, Uber. We don't talk to the checkout clerk because we don't have one anymore. We just kind of scan it on our own. And research really suggests that it's those simple social connections, you know, talking to the barista at the coffee shop or the person on the street, that can bump up well-being much more so than we forecast.
I think about, you know, the experience of dating. We used to be, you go to a bar, you try to, you know, you meet someone, and now, of course, you look at an app and
That's
you
correct.
Evaluate somebody on fairly superficial criteria, and you get evaluated, and that can be good for your sense of self-worth.
Yeah, it's also activating another thing we know from the research that can be problematic, which is our social comparison, right? Our mind is really good at picking out a reference point of who we should compare ourselves to. What should our salary be? You know, how good should we look? Well, we find someone else out there, and we compare ourselves, often in a bad way. And I think social media allows us for so much more kinds of comparisons that just make us feel bad about ourselves on all these different dimensions, our attractiveness, our wealth levels, for our college students, the grades they're getting. You know, nobody brags about getting a bad grade, but they talk about getting good grades. And so I worry a lot that the kind of tech we have are just increasing the number of social comparisons that happen on a daily basis, and that's just not good for well-being.
In the course, what do you try to give? What is the message you try to give about what does lead to the good life? What does lead to happiness?
Yeah, so the first part of the message is that a sad thing that the science tells us is that our minds lie to us all the time. We miswant things, and that's a hard thing to take. But we think that we need to change our life circumstances to become happier. We think we need a new job, we need a bigger salary, we need to move. But what the research suggests is that our life circumstances play a really little role. It's not what we forecast, but it's what the science shows. What plays a much bigger role are our simple practices, like simple acts like making a social connection, or taking time for gratitude, or taking time to be in the present moment, having some time that's unscheduled.
What's interesting about what you're describing actually is it's simpler than what we think. We think that what will make us happy is making a lot more money or moving to a different place or having a different apartment or, you know, partner or whatever. But what you're saying is really if every day you, you know, maybe follow some routines where you make sure that you, you know, meet with some friends, have a social interaction, maybe do a little exercise or whatever. Whatever your day-to-day routine is, that can make you much happier. And that's easy to do compared to doubling your income.
Exactly. I think I take the science of happiness as giving us a lot of good news, right? It's not the hard things that you need to change. It's just the simple things. The problem is that we know, as psychologists, even changing the simple things can be really hard. You know, that's why we're, you know, only a few months from January 1st, and everyone has forgotten about their New Year's resolutions. And that's why the second half of the class really focuses on a different part of psychology, and that's the psychology of behavior change. As scientists, we've learned a lot about how habits work, how you can make habits stick better. How can you shape your situation to pursue the goals that you really want to have in your life? You
know, is there a simple rule? Is there a simple answer to that?
I mean, as you might guess, since behavior change is hard, it's not super simple. One of the easy things to do is just do it. Find a way to force yourself to do it over time. We know that habits build up by just simply doing them over and over again. Another thing we know from the science is that your social situation matters. You want to be around people who are supporting you, who give you some help in forming these habits. And that was one of the wonderful things about the course, is that we had 1,200 students on Yale's campus. Almost one out of every four students at Yale was doing this. And that provided a tremendous amount of social support. You know, people were asking other students, like, you know, what did you write for your gratitude list today? Or, you know, what did you do for time affluence? And I think that was really powerful, knowing the whole community was doing this at the same time.
Laurie Santos, pleasure to have you on.
Thank you so much.
And we will be back.